Welcome everybody, and hello. And tonight you're going to learn about our Train Your Brain workshop. And this workshop is for anybody who feels like they are being held back in their life by their past, or feels stuck in their current job or current relationship, but does not see a way out because of money, time, or something else, or anybody who feels that they are not in control of their emotional states. The human brain is wired to create. And this is your birthright. And unfortunately, most people give it away by blaming others, the world, fate, or something else for what's holding them back in their lives. And at the completion of the Train Your Brain workshop, you'll understand that you already have the tools to transform your life into one of creation, joy, and self-empowerment in a systematic way on a day-to-day basis, if you're willing to do the work. That's always the case. If you're willing to do the necessary work.
Yeah.
So tonight we're going to just give you a little bit of an excerpt from the course and do a little exercise for you that so you can get a sense of kind of what's available and that you can practice after the workshop. And so first, Saimi and I will introduce ourselves. And so my name is Michael. Most of you probably already know me from breath work or something else. But I have a science background, and I got into breath work about 12, 13 years ago, and have been doing breath work workshops for that amount of time. And I'm extremely curious because of my science background about neuroscience, about the brain, about how it works. And for years and years and years of my life, I felt like I'm a smart guy. I should be able to figure all this stuff out. But there were certain areas of my life where I was held back by fear, where I was being unsuccessful and I couldn't figure out why I kept repeating the same patterns over and over again. And since I've done this studying with neuroscience and started working with Saimi on this workshop, it just isn't like that anymore. Life is more, at least for me, is more of an open, creative process where I kind of dive into stuff and where I would have, before I would have been afraid. And a perfect example is in my breath work, for years, people were asking me, oh, I love this breath work. I'm getting amazing results, but I want to do it on a regular basis. I want to do it like a practice, like yoga or like going to the gym. And I only do about, I was originally trained in holotropic breath work, which are all day workshops and cost over $200. And I only do about four or five a year just because they're a lot of work to put on. And at a certain point in one of my breathwork sessions, I got this kind of download. Okay, it's one of my kind of missions in life to allow whoever wants to experience breathwork to experience breathwork. And when I really thought about that, I figured out, okay, the only way to really do this is to do it online. Now, 5 years ago, if that had come up, my thought pattern would have been immediately, oh my God, you can't do this. You don't know anything about online marketing. You don't know anything about how to do anything online. You just have a Facebook group. That's it. 2 years ago, I had a flip phone. I didn't have a smartphone until 2 years ago. And I'm still learning how to use it totally. So, you know, my brain would have gone into the circle and going, you can never be successful at this. There's no way. And also, online stuff is for kids. It's for 25-year-olds. It's for 30-year-olds. You're a senior citizen. What are you thinking about? And I would never have done it. And I still had those thoughts, but I understood where they came from and I understood what was happening in my brain. And I just said, okay, let the thoughts come, let them go. I said, you know what? I feel that there is certain fear coming up. I understand where that's coming from. But by that time, I'd completely transformed my relationship to fear. And I see it now as, okay, if there's fear there, it means that's where to go. That's where how I grow. That's how I learn. So I do new things. So I just kind of plowed right into it and figured I'll figure this out. And so I got started and ultimately I did have to figure everything out. And rather than doing what I used to do, which is set safe goals that I knew I could do, in terms of number of people and number of countries, I probably would have said, in a year, maybe I'll have people from 7-8 countries and maybe 1,000 people on my mail list. Because it took me 10 years to get like 4,000 people in my in-person mail list. Instead, I'm going, no, my goal is to spread this to the world. I'm going to have people from 100 countries, 100,000 people within a couple of years. And within a year, I've got people from 100 countries. I haven't got 100,000 yet. I'm at 20,000 about. But if I hadn't set my goals like that, I would never, my brain would have never started to work with me to figure it out. So this workshop has completely transformed my life and the principles behind it. And that's why, from my perspective, I wanted to work with Saimi on presenting this information to other people so that they could get the same results in their life. Okay, you're up, Saimi.
Okay, all right. Hello, welcome to our webinar. I am Saimi Nakamura. I am a certified holotropic breathwork facilitator and a fractal psychology counselor. But these two credentials are the results of me being a seeker over 15 years. I was seeking for the healing modality to heal myself. So I am excited to present this work to you because of how profoundly holotropic breathwork and fractal psychology have shifted my life. During the majority of my adult life, I lived with fear, disappointment, and a sense of hopelessness, helplessness. But now, as a result of learning and practicing the theories of practice psychology and the principles of breath work, I have reached to the point of understanding that there is always a way to change my experience in this phenomenal world by just creating a shift in perception. I used to perceive that life was a struggle, a battlefield where I was barely surviving. I tried so many different healing modalities and receiving healings as well as taking courses and attending workshops and reading many, many self-help books and many years of psychotherapy. And after spending tens of thousands of dollars over the period of 15 years, I still could not figure out how to get rid of this negative self-talk and this dark, heavy energy stuck in my like a belly for so long. And it was a scary time because I thought there was nothing I could do to create a change, and I felt like I was out of control, and I had no idea how to stop being so miserable. So but it was not until much, much later that I learned through fractal psychology that I can change my neural wirings in my brain to create a shift in my perception. And with my renewed perspective, once I changed the angle from which to perceive my reality, then my reality started to change. I used to believe bitterness and resentment whenever I would remember my childhood, and I blamed my parents for my low self-esteem and the sadness in my heart. And when I imagined my future, it felt always gloomy and full of fear. Since my perspective has shifted, I remember new things that I didn't recognize before, I didn't remember before. And I could realize that I was the one caused sadness and broke my parents' hearts. And I have been doing a lot of work around that. And now all I have is an immense gratitude for my parents and how much they have given to me. I finally started to understand that magnitude of unconditional love from my parents. I could still choke up. And the appreciation, you know, this appreciation, renewed perspective and appreciation really motivated me to grow up and to become successful and happy, because that's what they wanted for me. And that is the time when I also started making money. Yay. And now when I imagine my future, it is full of wonder. Because I can sense the infinite opportunities and possibilities for me to choose from. That is the true freedom. Yeah. So do you see that time doesn't flow from the past to the present to the future? When I changed my worldview and how I perceive myself, then when I see my past, my brain selects the memories which support my new perspective in how I perceive myself. Yeah. And also, since my mind project my renewed perspective onto my future looks much brighter now. Yeah, in my reality, time flows from here, from me here, from this moment to the past, from me, this moment, to that future, right? So that core principle, sorry, a little bit more, the core principles of fractal psychology, the core principle of fractal psychology is thoughts create reality 100%. No exceptions. And I put a lot of elements of fractal psychology into the Train Your Brain workshop. And by learning the mechanism of mind and perception, and by practicing how to use your brain in a practical and effective manner, you will gradually start to recognize that you are the creator of your reality. It is not just a concept, but you'll be able to experience that you are the one who can manipulate this seemingly tangible reality, which some of the neuroscientists call controlled hallucination. And what is controlling this fascinating, mesmerizing hallucination? The five senses, which are operated by the brain, and old stories stored in the brain. You're the epicenter of your world, like a projector of your own movie called My Life. So I hope you will join us to learn and experience this mind-boggling concepts, ideas, and information to rewire your brain, you know, over the weekend. So, thank you.
And just to kind of expand on one of the things that Saimi said, where she said that basically in your present moment, that's the epicenter, and you basically create your past and your future, and that's her reality. That's just not her reality. That is how the brain works. And for instance, with memory, most people, and we talk about this a lot more in the class, I'm just kind of giving you a little overview. Most people think that memory works like a video camera. Like when something happens, you kind of video it, it gets stored in your brain. Then when you bring it back up, you bring up the video, you see it again. And each time that's what happens. And the reality is that that's completely wrong. That's what I used to think before I started studying this stuff. What really happens is that when you remember something, you remember it with an overlay of what your current belief system is and your current worldview is. Your brain hates dissonance. It hates things disagreeing with each other. So when you change your worldview, your brain basically rearranges the facts of the past to agree with your current worldview. And one example of a study that was done was that they gave 100 people a questionnaire about end-of-life decisions. And they all answered the questionnaire. And then a year later, they gave the same 100 people the same questions. And a certain percentage of them, about 23%, completely changed their answers to something different. And that in itself isn't that unusual. People do change their minds. But the interesting part was that out of those people, 75% insisted, like their life depended on it, that they'd answered the same way the year before. And so what their brain had done was they'd changed their opinion, and it had actually remanufactured their past in a completely incorrect way to agree with their current worldview. So you can imagine when you remember things tens of times, hundreds of times, every time you bring it up, it's different. And you don't remember how it was the last time. So we tend to base our present and our future and our limitations and what we can and can't do and our possibilities in life based on our past, you know, based on what we remember of what our past was. And that's how we basically choose our limitations. And once you see that your past is not real and we really don't know exactly what happened because we've changed it so many times, it really is, I mean, in one sense, it's got, oh my God, it's like, I can't trust my memory. I mean, that's a bit disconcerting. But on the other side of that, what it means is that you don't have to let your past hold you back. It's not real anyway. So you can kind of, you're unconsciously recreating your past anyway, all the time. So you can take control of that and consciously, basically recreate your past in a way that actually supports you and moves you forward in manifesting the life that you want in a very, very powerful way. So it's just, and we really dive into this in the course and do videos, so you really get a sense of it for yourself. And it's just a very, very powerful tool to use to manufacture your desired future. And we go into that in great detail. We also give you many exercises to work on that and take it home. And the second foundation that we use, there's two things that we really use to basically see our reality in this world. And like Saimi said, neuroscientists say that our reality is basically a controlled hallucination. And the reason being because these two fundamental things, memory and perception, both are very inaccurate. And I've already described memory, and we'll get to the questions also. You're welcome to ask questions, and we'll take a break every now and then to just respond to them, either tap into the chat box or we'll just respond to them verbally. So the second thing is perception. And again, most of us think that we see what's out there, we're looking out there, it's exactly what it is. And that everybody probably sees it in a very similar way, unless they have some kind of colorblind or something like that. And that couldn't be further from the truth. And the reality is that our conscious brain can only absorb about 5% of what our visual cortex takes in. So then you're thinking, well, how do we even see what's out there then? How do we create the other 95%? And our brain does it basically based on its expectations, its belief systems, its thoughts and prior experiences. So when we say it's a controlled hallucination, it's like 95% of what we see out there is in essence manufactured by our brain. And so what you're seeing out there, everybody else sees things that are completely different because everybody has prior experiences that are different than yours. And there's other factors that also make perception very inaccurate. One is, for instance, since our retina is flat, we see things in two dimensions. And then our brain has to recreate everything into a three-dimensional reality. So that's another thing that makes it inaccurate. In addition, in the back of our eye, we have a little place where we have a blank spot where we don't see anything, where it connects. So our brain has to make that up too, that little 5 or 10% that we don't, it's just a complete blank. Our brain fills it in. So our brain's doing this amazing work. It's really kind of almost, everybody's almost like an artist. And our brain is just creating a reality as we go. And the purpose of the brain is it's not designed to see what's actually out there. It's designed to basically see what's useful for us to navigate what's going on and to navigate this reality. So, you know, once you start getting into this place of, well, what I see out there is not real, what I remember is not real, then the question is, okay, how do I take this and how do I use this information? How do I deeply understand the mechanism of mind so that I can consciously use it to create the reality I want instead of it unconsciously running myself and where it's basically creating unconsciously this reality that we see out there, but not really to meet with our goals. It's just happening unconsciously without our direction at all. How can we take control of that process and use it really to move ourselves forward? And that's a big part of what the course is about. So you want to take over from there, Saimi?
Yes. Would you like to answer a question?
Oh, yeah, sure.
A couple of questions, okay. Please.
Yes. Okay. And the answer is the course accessible online? Right now, we've done the course about, 6 or 7 times, always been in person. We have a course coming up in February. Later this year, we plan on putting it online, but it's not there yet. Right now, we're only doing it in person at our home in Venice Beach.
Okay. All right. So I'll take it over. Today, this is a little bit of partially the mechanism of mind. And when we talk about, you know, we set it up goal, you know, this is what I want to do, but then seems like it's not just going, you know, the way you want it. Life doesn't moving to the direction you want it to. to go, and then why that happens and how we can resolve it. We will talk a little bit about that. So our brain has, you know, almost like a two parts. One part is, we call it child mind, the part of the brain which was created when you were formed, when you were 0 to 6 years old. We call it child mind. And the other part is adult mind, which is known as the frontal lobe and cortex, which is usually matured around the age of 25 to 30. And these two character parts of brain, two minds, have very, very opposite characteristics. As we grow older, we, you know, normally we assume that our brain grows older and matures, but that is only partially true. This part of brain, child mind, known as generally known as a limbic system, stays as it is unless your adult mind intervenes and then modifies it. And when we were working, or you know, we are, you know, taking a role as a responsible citizen, or you know, worker, or father or mother, then you know, usually this adult mind dominates your brain. But whenever it comes to emotions, or you become emotional, this part of brain just emotionally hijacks you and takes it over. So what we're going, you know, we do in train your brain is create a neural wirings, neural pathway between adult mind and a child mind. And we practice, you know, we do this brain exercises to start reinforcing this neural, you know, wirings to make it into like a bridge. So adult mind will take child minds to guide them, because you know, after all, it was created by 0 to 6, and you know, this part of brain is stores all sorts of ideas and thinking patterns and beliefs and definitions and stories which were created when you were 0 to 6 years old. So basically, this part of brain has an intelligence of 6 years old or younger, so it needs a guidance. So in the workshop, we create adult mind and a child mind, to connect them. So adult mind can take a leadership. Because, and then, so when we feel that, you know, life is stagnated, I feel like I'm trying, but I'm not getting anywhere. I feel stuck. That is because there's a disconnect between adult mind and a child mind. Yes, when that happens, because these two has a completely different characteristics, child minds, all idea is coming from dependent, you know, dependent victim mentality. Because 0 to 6 years old, you know, kids are very, very, yeah, dependent. Yes, so every idea came from the dependent idea, and on the contrary, adult mind has more independent idea. And child mind's story is everything is about emotions, but adult mind has ability to think logically and factually with problem solving ability. So for example, when your adult mind wants something, for example, like, oh, I want to get married and start a family. So that's what adult mind thinks. But child mind has the opposite idea that I don't want to lose freedom. You know, I don't want to take care of anybody. I only want to be taken care of. If you have that idea, it just, you know, wanting to get married, because you can't marry to yourself. I mean, you have to marry to someone else, and then you have to start thinking about other person too. So, you know, it's always child mind is me. What about me? What about me? I want this, I want that. But when you get married, you have to think about the other person. And also you have to start thinking about we. You know, what do we want to do? You know, what about us? You know, what's convenient for us to do this, do that? And, you know, schedule of a week in the vacations. So it's always we involved. And so if this strong notion that I don't want to, you know, lose my freedom, I always want to be taken care of, this strong notion still remains here. This can, it cancels out. Yes. And also, adult mind wants to make a lot of money, but the child mind, you know, has the idea that money is bad. You know, rich people must have done something nasty. Rich people are nasty. If you have the idea, you know, adult mind thinks like, oh, I want to make money. But then when you become rich, you know, you become nasty at the same time because you have a thinking pattern, remains thinking pattern, like rich people are nasty. So it just canceling out. You want to become a business owner. You know, this year I'm going to, you know, my New Year's resolution, I'm going to build a business. I want us just to build my own business. You think that way from adult mind, but the child mind, you know, this dependency idea is like, no, I don't want to take responsibility. I don't want to take care of anybody else. So completely opposite characteristics, then it's just the canceling out. So in the train your brain, we will find those hidden, you know, blocks that has been preventing you from moving forward. If you have these two conflicted ideas in your brain, adult mind holds one idea objective and then child mind has a completely opposite, then it is almost like you sit in your car, you get into your car and put the destination objective, you know, your goal on your GPS, and then you put one pedal on a gas pedal, but one foot, the other foot on the brake pedal. So, you know, you're just really not moving. You can't really, you know, drive and move forward to the destination you set it up. All you do is consuming gas. That's why these conflicting ideas, you know, people holding on to, you know, I'm trying, but then, you know, I feel exhausted. All I feel is exhausted, no motivation, because this is not, this part of brain is not motivated. So so that's going to happen. And also we talk about why this happens, you know, why this happens is that because this is my wonderful drawing of, like, for example, iceberg, you know, this kind of metaphorical consciousness, you know, drown as a iceberg. So this is a whole consciousness, this iceberg. But, you know, what we can really perceive, like Michael said, what we can really perceive is simply like a tip of the iceberg. We call it 5%, but, you know, actually it's much less than 5%, but for the sake of explaining everything visually, you know, we put a 5%, this top 5%. And then what we assume is that this whole, just the 5% is who I am, 100% I am, but it is just the 5% of a whole consciousness. And this, you know, tip of the iceberg, the surface above that sea line, you know, this is where we can use five senses to have this seemingly tangible experience. We can see, talk, and hear, and touch. So this is sea line. The sea line is a reality that we can just perceive as a reality, and then it, you know, we experience this tangible reality. But that is just simply less than 5%. But that's what we think. This is my whole life. This is a whole me. But train your brain and a fractal psychology, we deal with like this, including this majority part of deep consciousness and plus surface conscious level. This whole 100%. This is who you are. This is who I am. Not just this meager little part. And yes, yeah, because we don't understand that all the information stored in this deep subconscious mind, that's what usually create, you know, problem comes up, because we think this is just me. But there's a whole lot of information, also intelligence, this inner infinite intelligence and inner healing potential that we have access to through holotropic breathwork, is all stored in this part. And then we deal with, this is a whole 100% you and me. And this is just to really, you know, find those unconscious blocks. So this is like another, you know, my fabulous drawing of centipede. So this top 5%, like conscious, the surface conscious level, is like a head of that centipede. And then this decide, I want to do this, I want to do that. And then this whole, you know, underneath, this 95% is like a body of it. So if this whole body is aligned with the same goal, aligned to the same objectives and the goal, you know, we don't feel anything, you know, wrong, and we don't really recognize nothing, you know, everything goes smoothly. But when this conflict happens, you know, one way the head wants to go to that certain, you know, place, but then this hidden blocks or becomes a hindrance, those old thinking patterns, the stories, the definitions and beliefs, you know, become stayed, you know, the end of tail of the centipede. And it's, no, I don't want to go to that direction. I want to go to this direction. And then everything you plan with conscious, you know, surface conscious mind here will just be canceling out. So through the Train Your Brain workshop, we dive into this even that deeper subconscious level to find that there's a hidden unconscious blocks for you, then to remove it, so that you can start, you know, using your potential to move forward.
And one example from my own life where I wish I'd have had this technology, like when I was 25 years old instead of just recently, is that one of my goals from when I was growing up, okay, I want to be in a relationship. I want to be in a successful relationship. And it was kind of like modeled, like my parents had this very happy relationship. I want to be just like them. And every time I'd get into a relationship, it was a different person, but it would always end the same. It would always end in a lot of drama, like an intense breakup, usually after about a year, maybe a year and a quarter. It didn't last very long. And I always figured, I'm a pretty smart guy. I should be able to figure this out. What am I doing wrong? And, but every, you know, I'd try to analyze it out, but every time, same thing would happen. And it wasn't until just maybe about, 6-7 years ago in one of my breathwork sessions that I really got to the bottom of it. And what I saw was that when I was a child, both of my parents are Nazi Germany Jewish escapees, and they kind of barely escaped with their lives. And so when I was a kid, it was kind of like I was hearing the story that, oh, you know, we were in Germany, you know, our family had been part of German society for centuries. Your grandfather was a World War I hero. He earned the Iron Cross, the highest award possible. And then your great-great-grandfather saved the town from Napoleon coming through and burning it by paying him off to go around it. And then one day, we just had to run for our lives or die. And so I grew up with this kind of imprint. The world is an unsafe place. You can't trust anybody or anything. That's kind of what they were saying. You cannot trust your country. You know, just be careful. Be really careful. So, you know, just like Simon was saying, in terms of two things pulling different directions, on the surface, I wanted to be in a relationship desperately, but underneath I was going, the world's an unsafe place. I don't want to be in a relationship. It's scary. I can't open myself up and be vulnerable. It's not safe. But I wasn't aware of it because I couldn't use this technology. So, you know, so till I got this kind of insight of my breathwork thing, I was just doing the same thing over and over again, just repeating the same emotional dramas, time after time. And my logical mind couldn't figure it out because I wasn't connected to this kind of inner child, however you see it, that was kind of pulling in a different direction. So anyway, you can go ahead. That's kind of my example. If I wished I'd had this technology several decades ago, it would have saved me a lot of grief in relationships.
Okay.
Well, there's a few questions, Simi. So maybe we can
All right. So Bashi said it sounds similar. It sounds similar to IFS. I don't know what the IFS is. Inner bonding, it sounds really cool to have this info and awareness and to be able to dialogue with this subconscious, real part of us that is driving behavior behind the scene. Yes, that is really true. And it is really possible for us just to consciously create that, relationship between adult mind and a child mind. And then it is really, really a super empowering as well as super sweet thing. You can really cultivate your, compassion towards your inner child. Yes, this wounded, lost inner children, inner child. So it is a very empowering, self-empowering process, this is. So thank you for your comment. And Jan said, how do we find those childlike mental blocks in this program? So we have a different ways to do it, but then after this explanation, we're gonna do one of the brain exercises. So you can just be in touch, discover your child mind voice. Yes, so stay with it. Yeah.
And this is really just to give you, what we're going to do tonight is just to give you a little taste of what's in the workshop. But we have many, many exercises to actually allow you to connect and see what's going on and interact with what's going, like this kind of piece of yourself that's pulling in a different direction. Mm-hmm. And we also give you a bunch of exercises to take home with you. So it's not just the course. There's a practice that you create to actually keep this in your life and to use it going forward.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So Jacqueline said, what exactly in inner infinite intelligence? Is it beyond science to some degrees? And yes, it is. And get it. Yes. And also, who is operating this body, our internal organs, and how a body grows and then eat and then metabolize the food. And we don't know anything about it. That's our, inner intelligence, part of the inner intelligence. It is actually more. But, for example, is that, the inner healing potential that when we have a cut on our skin, we don't have to think about how, heal. We don't have to order it. But, our body knows how to, create a scab and under the protected, scab under the protection, just the cells, body cells rejuvenate and then mend it on its own. So those intelligences are stored. We're all born with it. But we have not really, we have no knowledge about it. We don't know how to access to it. We don't know much, knowledge about it. So this is a small portion, but then just really getting in touch with this inner intelligence and then just knowing that presence of it. We're all born with it. That is, already self-empowering. Yes.
And so you guys have to understand, I'm kind of a science nerd. So I apologize if I get into too much of the science, but there actually is, are theories out there now in quantum science about how this actually works and how we actually connect to this kind of universal field of information and already have all this information kind of in our psyche inside of us. And there's a whole article on that, and that's available at the course that we pass out if people are interested in it. So there is, science is kind of catching up now, in a sense. Okay, back to you. Yes.
Okay, so Beth, you might want to answer this. How do you teach to get past the polarization and train your brain? How do you do it if you have these conflicting energies?
Okay, go ahead.
Oh, okay, I'm going to answer that. Okay, so polarized, the idea is also child mind and adult mind, because these are very, very two, opposite characteristics and then pulling. So if these two has opposite ideas, that creates a conflict, the disalignment of surface conscious and then deep conscious. So that's what we examine. We, during the workshop, we would examine, and then how we can figure it out. And then when you see this disalignment, how we can, you know, this is, you know, connection is the key. We create adult mind and a child mind, connect them, and then how we can deal with it and balancing it. So that's what we're going to learn and practice during the workshop. So, and thank you, Valerie and Jacqueline. So what exactly the inner infinite intelligence is, it beyond sight? Oh, okay. I'm currently 23 years old. Is it going to be more difficult for me to access the adult brain at this point in my life? Yes, I would say so. Yes, a little bit. It might be difficult to. Yes, because your adult part of brain is not fully matured yet. But knowing about this, you know, just the ideas and concept might be also good for you to just, you know, growing up, and then, you know, your brain is just brilliant. It's just still in the development. So, you know, it might be interesting to absorb those ideas and concepts, you know, and learn it now so you can accelerate. And then not creating this, you know, this disorder, you know, you can start cleaning up this part of, you know, just negative thinking patterns. You can start discovering those negative thinking patterns, because we have a, in the course, we will, you know, we will change, reform certain ideas, definitions about certain things, definitions about love, definitions about work, definitions about freedom. You know, we would, you know, modify it so that, you know, it won't start, you know, it will stop creating hindrance or blocks or, you know, thinking patterns that would, you know, further prevent you from moving forward. So, yes.
Yeah, I think it's actually very, very effective for people in their 20s, because like Saimi said, you can kind of cut it off at the pass, where you don't have a decade or two decades of this, these neural pathways that have been created that are unhealthy. So it's kind of like you can kind of cut it off and go and start going in a different direction that's healthier. So it can be extremely effective to do it in your 20s.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It would be better. And I know that, you know, people in 20s, you guys have different brains. So I would love to see like how this really works and accelerate your brain development, you know, to the next level that our generation cannot reach. So yeah, that might be interesting. So.
And he said, what you're describing sounds like the perfect companion piece to what I've been experiencing in Michael's breathwork sessions. Mm. Yeah, over the last several weeks. The skills you're talking about sound like the tools to integrate and embody, yes, the openings that come through breathwork. And that's completely right on.
Yes.
It's an awesome integrative tool for breathwork. Breathwork, you use, you know, music and breath to kind of quiet your ego mind to get in touch with the unconscious and connect with it. But you can also do that consciously, just like we're talking about, you know, in this course. So you can kind of continue and integrate the breathwork process and work with what comes up. It's a very beautiful adjunct to breathwork. You want to say more about that, Simon? Or?
No, I think perfect. Okay. Yes. And then, so Valerie asked that, how do you guys develop the program? It is just, you know, we were fascinated and we were just groupies for holotropic breathworks, because it just gave me notion that, you know, everything what I've been going through, all the struggles, and it was like one breathwork session, I realized, oh my God, I've been just trapped in my own stories. Stories created when I was 4, when I was 3 years old, stories in here. So that was the beginning of it. And then I found a fractal psychology, or in a sense, I manifested, you know, I met the founder of fractal psychology in LA when she was living here for 6 years. And then she personally trained me to become a counselor. In Japan, there are many counselors and teachers of fractal psychologies, but nobody was really doing this here, using English and Japanese both. So I am the first fractal psychology counselor in English territory. So I'm very excited to share this information with you. So if we have time, we would like to move to the exercise that you can just use it at home. So let me see. And it is amazing that you have this amazing insight yourself, that you are trapped in your own. Yes, or usually it's hard to get to the, yes. And but the holotropic breathwork, you know, you can go into the expanded state of awareness. So in a sense, you get out, or you get pushed out of your own story, comfort zone. So familiarity, you know, ego mind dissolves and during the breathwork. So, you know, I could have the peak of it. And that was the beginning of really my self-discovery. And I'm not just this little body. Yeah, we're all like so humongous, like this part of intelligence is here. And once you start discovering more and more, you feel like you're just this enormous being. And, you know, really like when the Buddha was on the quest of, you know, discovering that way how to end the suffering. And what he discovered was exactly this. He, you know, he understood that, you know, only understanding who you are, who you really are, when it is recognized, you know, will set you free. So it's similar to, based on that kind of similar, yeah, the philosophy of Buddhism. So, but our goal of train your brain goal is that, you know, our head is like a projection, you know, hallucination. Where is it coming from? From your head. So your head is like a projector, and unconsciously, you know, projecting out all the stories from your child mind, and stories out there, and then recognizing it as a reality. So the goal of a train your brain is that, you know, to recognize it and, oh no, this is not the story I want to experience, you know, as my reality. So we intervene this and then stop projecting a story from here. And then we consciously start rewriting our own life stories and about, you know, stories about me, movie about me, who I am, and then create a new story. That's what we're going to start projecting it. So that's how we learn how to manifest our desired future. So switch the film from this and from here, from adult minds, you know, consciously rewriting your own story. So, and you're the star of that story. So that's wonderful. Yes. So yes, it is freeing and self-empowering. So wonderful. So let's go to the brain exercise that I prepared for you all. And this is, you can do it at home. Like someone asked about how can I recognize my child mind. This is a really, really good exercise to recognize your child mind's idea. So let me just do the share with you. This one. Okay, and full share. Okay, do you see it?
Yeah.
Okay. So you don't have to take a memo and, you know, let's go through this exercise together so you can kind of, you know, become familiar with this exercise, brain exercise. And later on, you can do it by yourself. But if you want to have this page, examples in a page, you know, you can send me email, then I will attach these pages as a file and then send it back to you. So you don't have to take a memo, write a memo right now. So let's go through it. This is a resolving a conflict. Yeah, brain exercise, work one, resolving a conflict in your head. We all have desires in life. And when it comes to making a decision to move forward toward to fulfill our desires, we are sometimes afraid of making bad choices and become hesitant to decide. So we put it aside thinking, oh, well, I will decide it later. And we will push it. We will keep pushing it back and procrastinate. And then we end up feeling stuck and nothing is improving in our lives and frustrated and stressed out and anxious. If this sounds familiar to you, yeah, this is a good brain exercise for you. Yes. And then, you know, these, you know, it sounds like, oh, I'm afraid to make bad decisions and I'm scared. And, you know, this was like, you know, basically it is excuses, you know, child mind excuses not to take responsibility to build your life or move forward, you know, improve yourself and skills or, you know, enhance your abilities for something. So this is all, you know, I'm afraid, hesitant, it's a hesitation. It's always excuses not to move forward. So let's find out what is your excuse. So first, you know, what is your goal that you haven't been able to achieve or a problem that you haven't been able to solve? For example, I want to change the job. I want to break up with my boyfriend or girlfriend. I'm going to write a screenplay, but I never seems to get on it. Or I want to start a business. I want to quit my job and go back to school and to get degrees. And so whatever you have objectives, you can write it down. And I would like to emphasize the power of writing, how important the writing is. Like consciously, when you write, you know, thoughts is easy. You always think like, oh, I'm on a New Year's resolution. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And then you just don't do it. But, you know, when you write something, it is consciously choosing words and then, you know, putting words and then, you know, using your muscle to really, really, you know, write or, you know, type it in. So, you know, that is like you take responsibility to welcome the, you know, unconscious mind's blocks or information in your under subconscious mind, welcoming the information to the, you know, up to the present conscious level. So you can really start sorting out, you know, what thinking pattern you need to eliminate, what idea you have to use and follow and stuff. So this is an example. Then, so one objective you can write, goal, to solve problems. And then you can start writing down, you know, your honest thoughts in your mind by taking two parts, you know, that have been creating the conflict in your head. So this is an example. Number one, the objective is I want to be in a healthy relationship, but I cannot find anyone. So you can just have two conversations. I said, I want to find a nice partner.
Why don't you?
Yeah, but I don't want to lose the freedom. I don't want to emotionally take care of anybody else.
Then you should be single.
Yeah, but I feel lonely, especially when my birthday is approaching and for holidays.
Well, then you should look for someone independent and just date.
Ugh, dating is hard. Are you kidding me? I don't wish to go through the disappointment and heartache anymore.
Then stay at home and watch romantic comedies.
Gosh, that's not real and not really exciting. So the truth is excitement is what you are really after in this case.
But you're the one who's not realistic since you don't have any desire to dedicate yourself to create a fulfilling relationship.
Well, but I have so much to offer.
For example, what can you offer?
Well, you know, I'm kind and generous, smart, with a good sense of humor.
Then start by offering your good qualities to your family, your close friends, your colleagues, and your community, and that will attract the right person's attention.
Yeah, but I want to say my good qualities for the special someone. This is a fake excuse.
So you're not generous then. You always attract the same kind of people as yourself.
So this writing, this example, this writing is almost like writing a stream of consciousness. So whatever comes up, you can just create a dialogue, X, Y, X, Y. And when you, you know, read it, after you complete it, and when you read it, you can tell which one is the child mind, you know, and all excuse, you know, I don't want to do. So this person, like X is that child mind, because it is the idea coming from X, you know, X part is dependent. You know, I just want to be entertained. You know, I want someone to excite me and then, you know, make me feel good, fulfill my needs, you know, good needs, but I don't want to do the same to the other person. So, and the Y part is more adult mind, more logical idea. You know, why you're the one not realistic, since you don't have any desire to dedicate yourself to create a fulfilling relationship, means like you want to be taken care of by the other person, but you have no desire to take care of the other person. So relationship is never going to be built in that condition. And also this part, you know, start offering your good qualities, you know, to the people around you, so that, you know, that could catch. If you become the best version of yourself, you know, you can start emanating the energy like that, then you will start someone like you, yourself. But still, X is, yeah, but I don't want to, but I'm going to say my good qualities for that special someone. That's a fake excuse. It's just lazy. So, you know, you can tell that. Okay, so let's go move on to example two. So this person has objective. I want to find a better job, but I don't want to, I don't know what I want to do next. So I'm going to quit my job, but I don't want what I want to do next.
Why don't you find a job that pays you well?
But then I cannot do what I want to do.
Why don't you choose what you want to do first?
But I don't want to work for less than what I currently make.
Then it would be best if you stayed with your job until you find what you really want to do.
Yeah, but I cannot grow where I am now.
That's totally not true. You should give yourself a challenge and apply for a higher position to enhance your value at the company.
You know, I cannot do anything else except what I am assigned to do by my boss.
Why don't you start trying to perform better than you're expected to do, so that your boss might consider giving you more responsibility, giving you a raise, and you might enjoy more challenging assignments?
I don't want to do extra work just to get attention from my boss.
I see you're the one who doesn't want to grow or work harder to perform better at work. Even if you quit your job, you will not try anything to find out what you want to do.
I will.
How are you going to find out what you want to do?
Well, it's something that I can enjoy doing a lot.
But you have to make a living doing it too.
Yeah, but that's why I cannot quit my job right now.
You can just find a hobby then.
Then I cannot quit my job.
So you just want to quit your job. You don't want to work. Isn't that true?
Well, my boss is boring, and I hate my boss, and excuse after excuse. So in this case, you know, this person has a wrong concept about work, because he expected work has to be entertaining. You know, it cannot be. It cannot be. So that definition about his or her, you know, work in his head, you know, needs to be changed. And then partially the adult logical mind knew that, you know, why don't you start performing better? So like a striving for something to enhance your ability, you know, by giving yourself a challenging assignment. You know, When the brain develops or grows is when the brain gets assignment or new assignment, getting challenges, like getting into the unknown territory. That's the time, brain gets developed. But usually egoic mind wants to stay at the same place because it is, in a sense, like a defense mechanism. You know, that part of a brain loves familiarity, and sameness, because it is safe, sense of comfort and the safetiness, our egoic mind feels, defense mechanism feels it. But, if you, life is an ever-changing phenomenon. So if you stuck at the same place forever, for brain, it is like, means death to our brain. So yes, this person, if you have a conversation like that, you can really see, follow that ideas, like why, why in this case, like, and then, adult part of your brain in this case is just really busting the child mind. Like, I see you don't want to work. You just want to quit your job. And if you quit your job, you're not going to do anything to find, what you want to do, because simply, it's just the brain is lazy and wants to stay at the where it is. But when brain gets bored, what brain does is like start creating fear-driven dramas. Yeah, that's what the child mind is really good at, creating dramas. So if this person quit a job, then another drama after drama. So that's what's going to happen. So that, person needs to develop their ability and skills. That is the goal. And so let's move on to exercise number 3. I want to break my habit of procrastination. This is a very common theme. I want to break my habit of procrastination.
Why can't you change?
I don't know. I've been this way all my life.
What are the negative consequences because you procrastinate?
I worry all the time and I feel stressed and frustrated a lot. I stay up to finish my report until 5 in the morning and I am really unfocused and tired the next day. It usually takes about 3 days to recover. And whenever I do this to myself, I say to myself, like, stupid, why didn't I start my report a week ago?
Yeah, why didn't you?
Because I binge watched Netflix and I wanted to finish reading a book. I usually prefer to do things to release my attention when I'm at home.
And you end up getting stressed out and anxious because you don't start preparing yourself to meet the deadline.
Well, I always make the deadline though. It's not hard to write the report for me.
Then why don't you get it done as soon as possible so that you can really relax and enjoy watching Netflix without worrying about the deadline?
That's a good suggestion. Why don't I do that then? I guess because I know I can get it done in one night if I don't sleep instead of dedicating my 3 free nights or my weekends.
But you usually scramble to put your report together so that you don't have time to put your thoughts and creativity into it and make your report more unique and insightful.
Writing reports is boring and there's no creativity involved.
So you procrastinate really to make it more exciting with stress, frustration, and agitation.
Oh, wow. That's true. Also, I feel my triumphs to a certain extent, like, yay, I made it. I got it done overnight. For the price of what? Price of all the stress and anxiety? It is so stupid. I will plan well next time and start much earlier. So you can clearly tell that which one, derived from your, from the child mind and adult mind. The voice that you need to follow is that the idea that will lead you to enhance your ability or take more responsibility and grow. That's the voice and notions you always need to follow. And then you can, conflicts can be resolved. So really writing out everything, it's really start clear up your cluttered thoughts. So this work is really effective. Right. And if you want this, you know, pages, send it to you, email it to you, you know, just send. Yes, please send me an email to request it. Mm-hmm.
To whom shall I send it?
Oh my God, my Siri is going crazy. Okay. Again, okay. So this is my email. So,
sorry,
Bashi.
I couldn't hear what you said.
Excuse me. So can you read questions or Bashir's comments?
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. Semi.com@gmail.com. Okay. So let me go up here, see where we left off. And okay, and then and just said deeply interested in learning what you have to teach. Thanks. And Bashi said, it's amazing that you had this, that you were trapped in your own, okay, we already read that one. Sorry about that. Sounds wonderful. Freeing, yes. Bashi said, I procrastinate. For me, it's protecting an underlying belief of not being good enough. If I do it at the last minute, it doesn't have to be as good because I didn't have time and have to use whatever I have. Do you want to comment on that, Femi, or?
Procrastination for me, it's protecting an underlying belief of not good enough. Yeah. Yes, but yes, so that you're not really enhancing your ability or just, you know, unleashing your true potential. Yeah, you just get it done, you know, scratch the surface, and then really not using your potential. Yeah.
Right. So, and it's really like the child mind fear that's coming up. Because if you do, like you're saying, if you do it at the last minute, then you have an excuse if it's not good or if it's not the best you can do. So it's kind of like creating this doorway of so if you fail, it doesn't feel so bad. That comes totally from child mind. And we teach you how to stop doing that. How to turn it over to your adult mind instead.
Yes. So you can just read this file over and over, and then you can start writing it. You know, and then you can recognize your voices from child mind and versus adult mind. That's how you can start finding a conflict in your brain.
Okay, so there's some more questions here. So Lynette asks, so it's the combination of identifying the child voice and then writing that down to bring it to the adult mind. She's asking, is that how it works? Lynette.
Bring it to the adult mind. Right, yes. So you can just perceive, because those both brains are inside of you. And ultimately, you know, adult mind will start recognizing child mind's voice, really like recognizing the existence of a child mind inside of you. That is the most important part of it, this exercise. So that you can, from adult mind, a logical point of view, you can give it to child mind and guide it. Child mind is amazing. It is all about wanting, but they didn't know. You can just fulfill yourself. And adult mind knows how to logically, factually, just knows, you know, how to fulfill this child mind's needs. Because child mind is basically has an intelligence of 6 years of or younger. Usually this desire is, I want to feel special. I want to feel good, you know, about myself, so that adult mind can intervene that and then really fulfill child needs, you know, desire. But, you know, for Bashir's case, like, if you really, really want to feel good about yourself, then you cannot procrastinate. You have to plan well and then, you know, do your best. You need to bring your, you know, best ability and put it out there to create whatever it is you're supposed to create. And then, wow, I did my best. And then you feel good about it, whether it is recognized or not. Just to, you know, really learn how to unleash your potential. And then adult mind needs to guide child mind. It's okay to do that. Let's do that. Don't hide it there. Yes. So that's about, you know, train yourself to just to do your best.
Mm-hmm. So then Lynette responded, so basically the child mind is running the show unless you recognize this and bring it into the adult mind. Aha.
Yes, when it comes to, especially when it comes to emotions, it's all about emotions. So when you are at a workplace, you have taken responsibility, you're in charge of doing, you know, whatever you're supposed to do, then this adult mind is running a show. Adult mind is dominating your brain. But whenever you come to home and relax and be with your, you know, family, then this part starts, you know, being activated. Yeah. And so, you know, you become more irritated and become emotional, become whiny or angry. And that happens, especially. So that's why people, you know, go to see your families over the holidays. You know, this part of child mind will kicks in, because, you know, crazy thing is, like, when you even become, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s, when you hear about other people's parents, you know, talk about their parents, you're listening from adult mind. But as soon as you start talking about your parents in you know, from your childhood, then this gets activated. And my parents are this way, that way, you know, it's just kind of crazy. But, you know, that's why we create neural wirings, you know, in that workshop. And then we learn how to consciously create neural wirings and reinforce neural bridge between child mind and adult mind, so we can start dealing with all those conflicts. And emotional hijacking will just start, you know, happening much less and less and less.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then we have another comment from Victor. Is it always the child mind holding you back, or can it be the opposite, the adult mind holding back the creative child?
Holding back the creative child. Usually child mind, yeah, child mind is great. It's just a creativity. It's this just life force. It's an energy wanting that is creating. But then, you know, the block comes from that is, you know, self-inflicted limitations and restrictions. Mm-hmm. Like my case, you know, the reason I couldn't reach to the success level in the entertainment industry, you know, that level that I wanted to go, I couldn't reach to the level, was because I was really bringing my, you know, putting my parents down. Yes. And then that, you know, created that law, thinking patterns in my brain. And so, you know, that's what I really understood when I did this work.
Yeah, I think that, like for me, the child mind is not bad. It's got this incredible energy, this wanting, this desire. It's just when it kind of is running the show without supervision from the adult mind that it gets you into a lot of trouble, because you're in essence letting a six-year-old run your life. And we do other work in the course to basically teach you how to connect and kind of work with this part of your brain, the emotional part. So it's kind of, you're working together basically to move you forward, and using that wanting, that intense energy, to actually drive you forward when you and your child mind can work together, rather than kind of being like this.
Yeah. And also, you know, Victor's idea that if your adult part of brain is not quite developed, you know, sometimes it is difficult to guide your child mind. Yeah. It's just, this nuclear energy, it's amazing. But, if it's not guided well, then, this energy will produce this destruction and chaos and then, fear-driven dramas. So, but it is guided and then, instructed to use it, outwardly, productively and creatively. Then this combination, this balance of, adult mind, child mind, energy balance will just produce anything, possible, really. This is a yes, Valerie's question. Yes, this is a reprogramming as well as manifesting your desired future. Mm-hmm. Really empowering yourself, removing blocks, empowering yourself, unleashing your potential, and reprogram as well. Rewrite your own story, as well as that's what you're going to manifest. So, okay. So
there's one last question.
Mm-hmm. And said, okay, it is possible to identify with, say, functional MRI scan, which brain is activated under specific circumstances? Or are the two brains more of a conceptual structure than neurological structures? Just curious what exactly we're talking about there.
Basically, the child brain is, it is in a sense a part of the brain, kind of that reptile, like primitive emotional part of your brain that's developed first, before, as you get older, like the frontal cortex, the reasoning part of your brain, develops later in life. That's why, people, when we're teenagers, we have very little emotional control, because that part of our brain isn't fully developed yet. So it is really a combination. It is conceptual, but there also are actual structures in the brain that relate to the adult brain, which is more like the frontal cortex, and the child brain, which is more kind of the reptilian part of your brain that develops first. So, yeah. Sammy, do you want to add to that?
Yeah. Or? So when you are emotional, this part of the brain is activated, limbic system. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when you are workplace, or you're, logically doing something, or people in the zone, in a sense, yeah, in the zone, and then. Yeah, it is, people like athletes, you go into Olympics or games and you're so in the zone, and those people cannot use emotions. There's no margin for them to be fearful or am I going to win today, or, no margin of emotions, to be in the zone. So in that sense, they're using not this part, but different parts of brain. So get to the maximum performance.
Okay, so that was the last question. And so we have one more thing to do, and that is to, Sammy, do you want to make some closing remarks? Or?
Okay, so if anyone wants that file, the writing file, the exercise work, please email me, because I don't know your email here. So please email me, saiminakamura@gmail.com. So I will send you the file. Yes. Okay. So what I want to say is so because I've been doing this work, I used to wake up with fear of when am I going to get another audition or job, or what if no one wants me? I'm gonna die alone and lonely. That was my fear waking up. But I don't have that kind of fear anymore. And now I consciously choose which challenge I am willing to take in order to grow my brain and expand my awareness. Life now feels like climbing a mountain, and I choose which mountain I would like to climb. And I ascend one step at a time with my own feet and spend my energy knowing I am going to conquer it one day. And it is fulfilling. Yes. I broke out of conditioning in my mind, in my head, the false sense of who I was. And I have started releasing myself from self-inflicted limitations and And I am a work in progress, and I am proud of that. Yeah, I can give myself permission to produce and contribute myself to create abundance in my life, and so can you. So I hope I will see you the weekend of February 8th and 9th, and let's expand together.
And just a quick thing for me, and that is, ever since I was a kid, I had a bit of an anxiety disorder. Even when I used to walk to school on the sidewalk, I used to have to step on every single one of the lines. If I missed one of the lines, I had to come back and step on it again. And I think part of it was because of this kind of underlying, the world is an unsafe place. And I really brought that into my adulthood, where, like, when I was getting up in the morning, I was coming from a place of fear. What, you know, is my world going to fall apart today? What can go wrong? You know, more like that kind of a place. And I just don't wake up like that anymore. I wake up in a very calm place and just kind of excited to, what can I create today? How can I build my business? How can I get breath work out there more? You know, in a very, very different place. And it's just made a huge difference in my life. And we really want to kind of spread this around to, you know, allow everybody else to have the same benefit in their lives too. So that's, thank you so much for participating. We'll add you all to the list, to our Train Your Brain mail list. So even if you can't make this one, we'll be telling you when it does come online or for future workshops. And just thank you so much for your time and for taking this hour and a quarter out of your life to learn more about this course.
Yes. Thank you so much. Okay. Bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.